Welcome to this edition of Peake Life. Today we're talking with Dr. Robert Hitt, director of the Chesapeake Planetarium. Dr. Hitt, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
Now, the planetarium is in its 55th year here at the city. Can you talk a little bit about your time at the planetarium and some of the changes you've seen over the years?
Well, the planetarium is 55 years old. It was built in the 62-63 school term. I came there as director in 1970, so I've been there almost 50 years.
Wow.
And it's changed a lot.
I can imagine.
And we hope it continues to change and evolve as we move to the future.
So I know, like, back in the day, and I won't date myself, I remember going there as a child. I'm from Chesapeake, so what kind of changes have you seen as far as technology?
Well, the equipment has changed a great deal. We have different kinds of equipment in there. The planetarium has evolved. We went from slide projectors to video projectors.
Wow. Okay, here's a quick shot of, wow, the buses have changed too.
Yes, that's a pretty that's a vintage shot. That goes back to the 60s.
Wow.
And the buses show up and the students come in and we seat about 110 at each program and we go by grade level. But the technology has advanced so much that now it's the entire facility is run by a system of large computers that you pre-program. More modern picture of the planetarium shows. This was just the other day.
And look at the tree, how much
and
it's grown.
The tree has grown, yes. It's interesting, there were four trees in front of that building and two of them died. I did not kill them, but they died. And it's a good thing they're not there because we often have our telescope out there and we would not see anything with those big trees if they were still there. But the technology inside is a very graphic, very computer-based, and we can literally cover the entire dome with amazing images.
That's a cool shot.
This is a shot of the interior showing a panorama around the edge of the dome and the original machine, which is still there, but we've lowered the machine down into the floor. It's on an elevator to make room for the new equipment. This is the process of getting the machine ready to be lowered into the floor, and we had to clear the view across the dome because there are two projectors that cover the entire dome. One shoots north, one shoots south, and they cover the dome in a seamless picture.
That's pretty amazing. There you are.
Yeah, it's hard. This new system uses a computer, a mouse, and a keyboard, and I'm used to turning knobs and buttons. So I can find the knobs and buttons in the dark, but reading the keyboard and the screen is tough. And this is the menu for the new planetarium. The picture on the right shows what's going to appear in the dome, and on the left are all the menus that you can select to cause those images to show up. And
now, would you have ever foreseen this back when you started as director of the planetarium almost 50 years ago?
I know. No, not really. But what this can do is amazing because before, if I wanted to put something in the dome, there were like 25 slide projectors. I would have to load slides in and program those to come up. Now, with a mouse and a keystroke, I can cause multiple images to come up, and it usually works very, very efficiently. So it's quite nice. And it's exciting because we can put full dome motion pictures on the ceiling. Like any good computer system, though, sometimes they don't work like you'd like. The second program I gave, we had no stars. I couldn't get any stars on the dome. So I showed everybody a full dome motion picture, which they enjoyed, but it wasn't what they really came to
see. Well, sometimes we don't see stars, right?
That's true. We said
that
it was a cloudy night.
Yeah, there you go. True. Now, you do a lot of school programs. Can you talk a little bit about that? Because I would imagine that most of the students here in Chesapeake have been through the planetarium.
Yes, in fact, tremendous number of students come through there. And we base our programs on the grade level and the Virginia SOL, the standards of learning for each grade level. So we try to cover what the teachers are covering in the classroom. And so each grade level receives a program designed for that area of topics that they're dealing in the classroom. So it's kind of a support structure for the teachers. We're there to support what they're doing.
And you said how many students come through, would you say?
Well, there are about 3,600 students in each grade level. So we will see all the students in grade 3 through 6. We'll also see some of the high school classes as well, but mostly elementary. And then, of course, we do public programs for the general public as well.
Now, would you say that the students' interest has changed over the years?
They've gotten a lot smarter.
Yeah,
and the students always want to tell me something they've heard on the news.
Well,
students like science. Mm-hmm. And so this is a great science motivator. Mm-hmm. I can have 110 third graders in there and you could hear a pin drop. They're so involved in what's going on.
That's great. That's really great. And now the general public, they're allowed to come too, of course.
They are. We have shows at night. And the big plus about coming to the night shows, we have a big telescope.
Okay, there it is.
That's our scope. We've had that scope for a lot of years, and I could not begin to tell you how many people look through that telescope. It's an amazing view of the rings of Saturn or the moons of Jupiter, and everybody simply enjoys that.
And it's held up for quite a while.
It's amazing. We take it in and out of the building that's on a great big base with wheels. And all the optics have stayed aligned for 20 years, which is quite remarkable.
That is amazing. Now, if somebody wants to say, or they're interested in a specific program, say,
right.
the public, they would just call the planetarium?
Well, they call the main school switchboard.
Okay.
They take the reservation list. Special groups call me direct in my office, but for general reservations, it's the school switchboard. And they take the reservations, and then I get that sheet later in that day of the show. And we check the list at the door. Mm-hmm. And people without reservations were asked to wait until just before showtime. If there are seats available, they can take them.
All right. So it sounds like you have a steady flow coming
through. We have a large crowd.
That's
we're full
great.
Almost every night,
that
which is
really,
good.
That is really great. Now, what is the sky calendar?
We print a sky calendar that lists what's going on in the backyard sky. So this calendar will have the dates when Venus is next to the moon, like this evening. If you look in the west after sunset, Venus would be there. It goes through the phases of the moon. It goes through if there's an eclipse, a solar eclipse or a lunar eclipse. It also covers the season dates that change. So we try to make that available every year. People can pick one up in our lobby as they enter the planetarium building.
Yeah, I've been on your website and it's got a lot of information. So
it also has a list of the public shows. They change every month. We run the same program for a month and then we change. Right now it's on the Zodiac. It's going to be on aliens. It's going to be on Stonehenge. It's going to be on the summer stars. So it changes monthly.
Now, is there a fee associated with it? Or
The general public programs are free. Sometimes groups or organizations want a program other than our regular public night. And if we can do that, sometimes there is a modest fee for that.
Okay. Now, I'm dying to know, what is this? You brought this with you.
This is a celestial globe.
And
it's interesting. If you look at this, you'll notice the writing's all backwards because this is supposed to be a view as if you're inside this globe. And the planetarium actually works like we put you inside a globe. The ceiling is a dome, and we fill it with stars. And so this is a globe showing the 88 constellations in the night sky and the Milky Way.
Now, the only one I can seem to locate is Orion's Belt.
I don't know why.
I can't find anything else.
That's actually the best ones to find. Orion, if you find Orion, you can lead off with other constellations by using the belt as a guide. And I always start with Orion in the night sky there.
Well, that's the only one I'm able to locate. So it sounds like I need to brush up on my skills and come visit the planetarium. So now, what is happening with, I know we talked a little bit about the technology, and what's in the future that you foresee for the planetarium?
Okay, we've updated the technology, and the new technology can be moved into a new theater. So we'd like to build a larger planetarium. We can certainly use one. And we'd like to build a science center connected with it so that when students arrive, not only do they have the planetarium to experience, but they have lots of hands-on exhibits to experience as well. And we also want to build a new observatory, and we want to build all this in a dark sky location, which Chesapeake has some dark sky locations out towards the Dismal Swamp area.
Definitely in the country. It's amazing how, like, when you don't have all the light from the city, that you can really see the stars.
Yeah, people are amazed at what the sky looks like.
Yeah, definitely. It's beautiful. Well, thank you so much for joining us. I appreciate it, and this is fascinating, and I will be visiting the planetarium soon.
Well, good. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Well, that does it for this edition of Peake Life. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time.